It was a period which is usually defined by historians as a time between 1947, 1991, 1947, which is the moment of so-called Truman Doctrine was announced, and the United States started to support countries threatened by Soviet Union or expansion of communism, and 1991, in fact, December 1991 is the time of the collapse of Soviet Union. A few months earlier, Warsaw Pact was dissolved. So, Cold War left many material relics which can be studied today and interpreted within archaeology. That's obviously a map of Europe. Good reminder to some people that some time ago, not so long time ago, Europe was divided between two hostile fractions, Warsaw Pact, Eastern Bloc, and NATO countries. And of course, they are also countries, white countries, which were in theory neutral, but as we know, in the case of nuclear conflict, none of the countries would be neutral. And the main aim of my today's presentation is actually to show what can we add to the studies or understanding of the Cold War when we use archaeology, and if archaeology can help us to add some additional information or additional value. And there's always this question, if we want to study recent past events, is it better to do it through history or archaeology? And in my opinion, history, if archaeologists want to study Cold War or some modern conflicts, you have to be both historian and archaeologist at the same time, because knowledge of historical sources and historical background is crucial for understanding of material relics we're dealing with. But then again, being archaeologist and having this anthropological perspective is very useful when we want to criticize some sources and connect them together, and those are location of three case studies I want to speak about today. Three top secret Soviet tactical nuclear warhead storage facilities that were located in Poland, and most of them are now badly damaged. So the further part of my presentation is thought to present you first the point of view from historical sources, so to tell what can we actually learn from historical sources, and later on I will try to show some archaeological results and how can we add, what can we benefit from archaeological perspective. So there's a quite large set of data which is stored in the archives of Institute of National Remembrance, which speaks about the Wisła project, and this is actually the project related to the building of those three tactical nuclear storage facilities in Poland, and there are some documents, official decisions, agreements between Soviet Union and Poland. However, this set of documents cannot be considered as complete, and later on I will explain you why I believe so. And we have also access to CIA reports, NATO reports. That's also a unique situation for contemporary Europe, because 10 or 20 years ago it would be impossible. Right now we can learn what the other side of the conflict knew about Poland and about the weapon of mass destruction within the borders of Poland. The problem with those reports is that they are censored, so it's quite hard to actually interpret them, even though they are written in very clear, very military, plain language. So they are easy to read, but difficult to understand. So we can learn from those historical sources, for example, the simple answers we usually ask at the beginning of our studies. So why the facilities were built? And, it was done due to some joint Polish-Russian military training that took place at the end of February 1965, when part of this training, this military training which took place at the Krasnokomorskie in northwestern part of Poland, was designed to examine how much time is required to transport tactical nuclear warheads from western part of Soviet Union to northern part, west northern part of Poland, and then arm R-11M ballistic missile systems and use them against NATO. So it was kind of training for preparation for nuclear war in Europe, and the result of this training was that convoys which were carrying those nuclear warheads would be vulnerable. It would take too much time to transport those warheads to the northwestern part of Poland, and the conclusion made by Warsaw Pact analysts, military analysts, was that in a case of war, in a case of future war in Europe, if it goes nuclear, then Warsaw Pact would be unable to answer to the threat on time with all its nuclear potential, and war would be most possibly lost, and the decision was made to that three nuclear facilities have to be built along the western part of Poland, just to bring those nuclear warheads closer and to shorten the time of gaining readiness before the war. And similar trainings are also made at different countries of Central Europe and different countries of Warsaw Pact at the same time. So it can be seen that it was only a pretext, really, because we don't need to the training to make such decision or to understand that situation, but probably someone just try to be persuasive and convince the local politicians that it's necessary to do so to be ready. So on 25th of February 1967, the decision was made that those facilities have to be built, and the agreement between the representative of Polish and Soviet governments were signed. And similar decisions were made also in other countries, in East Germany, in Czechoslovakia, in Bulgaria and Hungary, and similar bases were built there. The decision, the plan, the master plan was simple but very effective. Polish side was obliged to build three of such bases based on plans supplied by Soviet Union, and then those bases were to be handed over to Soviet troops, and during the time of peace, when the Soviet troops had complete access and control over all those warheads, but in the case of war, some of those warheads, we actually know that there was 60 nuclear warheads at each of three facilities that were to be shared with Polish units, Polish rocket units, Polish heavy artillery, and Polish air forces. And the TNT equivalent of those nuclear warheads varied from 3 kilotons to 500 kilotons. So the last one, the most powerful, was most possibly also thermonuclear. So if you imagine that the bomb dropped on Hiroshima was about 16 kilotons, then you know that although it was only tactical nuclear forces, so short-range carriers, we were still very powerful, and probably the war would end the civilization, or at least the history of Europe itself. And on 12th of December 1969, those bases were finished and they were handed over to Soviet troops. And from the perspective of documents, historical documents, it seems like the end of the history end, because everything was handed over. There are no new documents that were added to the Wisła files. And we don't know what happened there for the another 20 years until 1991, when those bases were abandoned. And the special instruction was issued, which was saying that vital documents have to be destroyed, and maps and plans have to be destroyed and or sent back to Moscow. So there are no plans, no maps of those bases. And if we wish to use some of the photographs that were made by Polish topographical services, then we learned that they were all censored. So, and those bases were not shown at any of the civilian or military maps either. So we got just empty space, the forest there. So everything, all the documentation that was created denies their existence. Those were places that were to be never known and later on forgotten. So what can archaeological perspective bring to our studies? It can, for example, explain us how those bases were built and how we were specially organized. Like I said, there are no plans, no maps, no explanation for them. So we have to build from scratch those plans using different types of sources. From all three bases that were built in Poland, two are now completely destroyed, and one is still existing, but in more or less good state of preservation, if we speak about buildings, but the surrounding was destroyed as well. So this is the example of Podborsko. Right now it's a branch of the Museum of Polish Arms and Kłodzek, and it can be visited. And it's well preserved because it was turned into a state detention center, the part where soldiers live and the part where the bunkers were on a museum. So this is the only place that is preserved. However, the surrounding or the infrastructure was in the meantime destroyed. So based on this example, I will explain you how those three bases were built. Even though all of them had different special plans, they consist of the very same elements. They were organized in a similar way. So when we look at the base, we see two main zones, the overbuilt zone and the restricted zone, special zone with tactical nuclear warheads. So the overbuilt zone, this is photography from the middle of 1990s. The overbuilt zone was built of the houses, quarters for NCOs, non-commissioned officers. I showed you this, those buildings before at the beginning of this session with the with children. Here are the view, is the view from the other side, and some photograph that was sent by one of the soldiers who served there. And just beside this zone, there was officer's zone, which was consisted of the flats for families of officers and officers, but there was also gathering hall, there was kindergarten. Here, this one is kindergarten. At every base, it's between the NCO zone and officer zone. There was a small swimming pool with a steam bath, some laundry, so all the elements you need to have this illusion of everyday civilian life. And just behind high wooden wall, there was a barrack zone where soldiers of compulsory training lived and trained, and because you said of the warehouses, but there was also barracks, headquarters, cinema and dining room for 160 soldiers, hospital and another barracks. A large part of this overbuilt zone was the garage zone. In the case of war, Soviet troops had to be sure that they would be able to transport nuclear warheads from the base to the rendezvous places with rocket units, and then or air forces or heavy artillery, and then they would be able to hand over those warheads to the Polish troops. And therefore, large number of trucks had to be kept for all the time within the base. So quite big garages, and that's original photography from that place. And just beside the overbuilt zone, there was a restricted zone, which was surrounded by triple fence, which I will show you on later. And the main part of the zone was, cooperate. Okay, the main part of the zone were two monolith, so-called monolith bunkers. Those were two storage structures. This is the contemporary photography, so it looked completely different in the past. And they were two-storied. This is my main maneuvering hall with cranes, but also efficient air conditioning systems at every room with warheads. There were also heaters. This was important to keep the very stable temperature for long-term storage of plutonium and uranium that were actually fissile material in those warheads. So there were four such rooms at the right side, which were used for the storage purposes of those warheads. And unfortunately, at two other bases, those buildings were destroyed inside because they were just left and then robbed. And that's photographs of one of the bases from Templevo and one of the rooms. And as you can see, I have the Geiger-Müller meter, which shows no radiation, and there were no radiation, nothing wrong happened at all those three facilities. So we did not measure anything like that, and I did this, of course, with help of atomic physicists. So it's not like I just took meter and went there, and I did not know what I measured. They explained it. Okay. In the end of 1970s, a new facility was built. New building was built within the base, and it was granite bunker. And this is how And this is how it looks like now. It's the only one well preserved at Podborsko. It was built of prefabricates, which were brought on site and just covered with soil. We don't have any documentation for that because, like I said, everything that will happen within those bases after 1969, after December, is not in the files. And that's the other example from other base. It was destroyed and gates were removed. However, due to this situation, you can see that there is you can see the prefabricates, how the building was constructed. And the whole site, whole restricted zone was surrounded by triple trench, so as you can see, concrete trench, and then inside so-called sofna or pine type of fence, which was connected to the signalization system. So it was, if it was broken, then it triggered quite an alarm, and then officer could send some soldiers just to check on what's going on outside. Every base had also its own shooting range. And this is one relics of shooting range. And at some time, at some stage, someone decided that it would be unsafe in the case of war if all those loaded, if all those trucks loaded with tactical nuclear warheads would have to go back to the parking area because they would be very easy targets. So when the trucks would be loaded, they had to go to the shelters, air shelters that were created around the base. So as you can see, that was four groups. Probably all those four groups later on were to go to choose different four roads, just to not create traffic jam and to be able to move very quickly. And those, this is original photography of one of the trainings that was done on site. And those are relics of such shelter from Templemo.
Come on.
All the roads within the base were built of such concrete plates, and we have two advantages. The first one is that they can withstand heavy vehicle movement. The other one is that they're greyish and perforated. So believe me, it's impossible to differentiate them at aerial photographs from ordinary ground roads. If the asphalt roads were built here, then it would be easy to recognize them and identify them, but in this case it was impossible. So it's good for camouflage of the site. And whole area, if you look at this, all those red lines are actually trenches or relics of trenches, because some of them were backfilled. And those were to be used for protection of the base in the case of attack. And some checkpoints, some observation points and such things. And of course, kill boxes incorporated into the system of defenses. So the question is probably, maybe some of you asked this question, well, did the enemy knew about those sites? So before I will answer this question, first I will show you some of the Corona program imagery that was collected for CIA. So that will be, I will use this. I will do this in traditional way. Okay, so that would be Podborsko, and the way it looked at satellite imagery on July 1969, so before the time when the base was actually finished and handed over. And as you can see, the most important part of this base are already on site. So two monolith bunkers, there is no granite bunker yet. There is shooting range, some garages and some quarters that were already built here. And that's Brzeznica Colonia. Like I said, it has a bit different special plan, but it consists of the very same element and even a better imagery here that shows the base. And that's Templevo, bit different plan again, but all the elements are visible. And it looks like it was main Achilles heel of this, those bases that were, they consisted of the very same element. However, we have to remember that only because something was very well photographed, high quality photographed from the cosmic space, does not necessarily mean that CIA photo interpreters interpreted the purpose of those bases properly. And it looks like they did not know, at least for 2 years since they had those photographs. So in the report, Warsaw Pact Forces for Operations in Eurasia from November 1979, they say that we cannot tell for sure whether any nuclear weapons at all are stored in Eastern Europe. So it means they got photographs, but they do not know what they photographed. But eventually, at the end of 1972, there was a new report, and in this report, those bases are mentioned. And this report also explained what was the Achilles heel of those bases. Those bases are called two bunker storage sites. So the main problem with those bases was that there were three such bases at Poland, but also another nine at the other countries of Central Europe, and all of them consisted of the same elements. So photo interpreters had just to focus on the main feature of those objects. And if you know the explanation, the interpretation key for one of such bases, you know them all, because then they stop to be secret anymore, and it looks like what happened here. So they were identified and the purpose was already known. And there's that later report where someone just forgot to censor the map, because most of the maps and those reports have been censored from 1979. And those three triangles here are the bases I spoke about, and the other geometric figures are the temporary storage facilities. So in the case of war, for 2-3 days, those warheads could be stored also at those different places. And as you can see, Poland was just a part of much larger system of nuclear bases. And that's one of the material witnesses of the last technical control of the monolith bunker at Podborsko was done on 26th of February, 1991. Another one, next one, was planned for the 1992, but it never happened, because in the meantime, Soviet Union collapsed and Russian soldiers just were withdrawn from Poland, leaving everything behind, and those are also material witnesses of the past. Trees from temple level where some carvings were left by soldiers, like with years, or the names of the places where it came from. It says Erevan is a city in Russia. And DMB, Dembia, that's the year when the soldiers who wrote this was to be demobilized. However, due to counter-intelligence activities, from time to time officers were sending soldiers to erase what they wrote, or the information that could be of use for the enemy intelligence. So only some dates were left and such things. So it can be said that even treaties were made to remain quiet and to not betray the secret history of those places. And mostly that's all I wanted to say to you. Of course, behind those material relics, there is much more to tell. There's a large story behind them. I just used some of the parts, and I would leave you with the most interesting, or inspiring allegory of the Cold War I actually seen. This is graffiti that was done inside one of the monolith bunkers at one of the bases at temple level. So two cats playing nuclear ball. Thank you very much for listening.